What actually makes something overpowered? I don't mean this kind of overpowered. I mean like actually overpowered. Characters that completely outmatch everybody else in fighting games, guns that feel like they're strictly better options than anything else available, and abilities that just accomplish too many things at once. I've personally noticed there's multiple kinds of overpowered. There are lots of ways something can be overpowered. Dealing too much damage doesn't necessarily mean it's overpowered, but on the other hand, something having weaknesses and counters doesn't make it balanced either. It's much more nuanced than, I hate this, therefore nerf it. Also worth mentioning, a lot of the things that I'm going to talk about in this video have been nerfed multiple times, so if the footage in the background's post-nerf, then I apologise. So let's jump into some examples, and let's get the obvious one out of the way first.
Know my power.
The first example of overpowered, probably the most egregious in the whole video. Meta Knight's just low-hanging fruit by now, but he's so disgusting that you can't not talk about him in a video like this. Simply put, the thing that makes Meta Knight so good is that he can do everything and you can't stop him from doing everything. His moves come out very fast, they're very versatile, and they outrange most other melee characters, including Marth. He has four recovery abilities, not including his jumps, that all have high priority, meaning that most moves can't knock him out of his own move. No other character in the game can challenge Meta Knight in the air, and nothing forces Meta Knight to ever have to come down from the air, ever. He's an obvious example of a character that can just do everything. Usually characters in fighting games will have strengths and weaknesses, pros and cons lists that players will be able to take advantage of when they're playing as them or fighting against any given character. Some characters' strengths will overlap, obviously that's not a fault in the game design, but Meta Knight can do everything that most other characters can do, but he can do it better than they can. His only real weakness to speak of is fighting on the ground against projectile characters, but it's not a huge weakness because Meta Knight players have no real reason to not just camp in the air with their down air, because their down air is just so good. This is the most obvious form of overpowered, and it doesn't really take much analysis to see why. He's powerful, and he has no real weaknesses to speak of. But this is where things get a little bit more interesting. It gets a lot more nuanced when we come to talk about an example that I don't really see brought up often enough when people start talking about overpowered characters.
Shurima, your emperor has returned.
Azir's moveset is incredibly difficult to use to its full potential. The vast majority of the game's player base was nowhere close to being able to use him effectively. It essentially meant that anyone who wasn't in the top 5% of players would have very, very mixed results. Anyone who was in that top 5% of players, however, just got a free win for picking Azir because he was way too good if you knew how to play him. This created a huge divide between the player base's best and worst players. His kit forced you to manage your own position, as well as the positions of up to 3 extra soldiers that he can summon on the spot. He was incredibly immobile unless you used difficult to execute movement options to evade enemy attacks, and his most powerful combos were extremely difficult to pull off. His entire job was dealing damage, and you could only deal damage through extremely precise mouse movements and button presses and combos and stuff. He was extremely squishy as a character, it didn't take much to kill him, but attacking other people in return, as well as evading them, was extremely difficult for him. Combine all of this with all of the other stuff that League of Legends asks you to do, like last hitting, minimap awareness, pressuring your lane opponent, blah blah blah, and you had a character that no low tier players could even touch and win a game with. As you can imagine, the playtesting team for Azir aren't quite as good as the professional League of Legends players that would go on to abuse Azir in pro play. It's hard to really blame the design team for not realizing that Azir was going to be so abused. LCS pros found that Azir was completely unstoppable in their games because they found it easy to abuse his strengths and hide his weaknesses, and this put Riot in a really difficult position. Riot Games had to make the decision to either completely redesign the kit of a brand new champion like 2 weeks later after releasing him, or they had to nerf his damage numbers into the ground and just pretend he didn't exist for a while. Azir to this day is still a nightmare to balance. It wouldn't take much of a buff in his damage to completely destroy competitive play while completely leaving the lower levels untouched. His kit is inherently broken, Not because it's too strong, but because it's just too hard to master. The goal is to build a character like, dare I say it, Yasuo. Characters who the peasants can play and still have success with, but still have a high skill ceiling that the pro players can have fun with without completely destroying esports as we know it. When balancing a game, developers need to be very, very conscious of skill gaps, because usually balancing around the most skilled players is a good idea. If a character is balanced for the top 1% of players in the game, there is no way it can be overpowered for the weaker players. Weaker players might struggle against certain characters or playstyles, but that doesn't make the character or playstyle overpowered. It means that the player themselves need to learn how to combat the strategy. Nerfing characters based on low-level players causes a big issue where certain characters can become too weak or too strong for the best players in the world. Each game genre will have different balancing limitations. MOBAs might have to worry about godlike players abusing a character's kit, but fast-paced first-person shooters have very, very different worries.
Oh, they're going to have to glue you back together in hell!
The Lock and Load, a primary weapon for the Demo Man that was so good that it destroyed most justifiable reasons to use the default grenade launcher. In typical Valve fashion, it took them 4 years to even attempt to nerf it despite community outcry. Its stats were pretty simple. Compared to the default grenade launcher, it did 20% more damage and had a faster projectile speed, but in return it sacrificed 50% of the ammo in its clip and the grenades wouldn't roll around on the floor if they missed. If you didn't directly hit an enemy with your shot, it did zero damage. It seems so innocent. The Soldier had a weapon with a similar concept in mind called the Direct Hit. Rewards players for direct hits and punishes them for attempting to use splash damage, just like the Lock and Load does. The Lock and Load was overpowered for one real reason. It could do 125 damage or more in a single shot. If you've never played Team Fortress 2, it might seem like a really arbitrary line to draw, 125, but bear in mind that all of the light classes in Team Fortress 2 only have a maximum of 125 health. That means that the Sniper, Spire, Engineer, and Scout would die in one well-placed shot from this gun. 4 out of the 9 classes die before there's any real chance for them to react just because they looked at a Demo Man wrong. Maybe this would be fine if it was difficult to aim the weapon, but it wasn't. Landing direct with this gun was easier than the normal grenade launcher because of the increased projectile speed. Even if you'd only installed the game 15 minutes ago and couldn't hit the broadside of a barn if you tried, there was no real reason you wouldn't just spam grenades down a corridor until you accidentally killed a scout in one hit. Engineer's sentry gun has just over 200 health. The default grenade launcher requires 3 direct grenades to destroy the sentry gun. The engineer has the time it takes for 3 grenades to be fired, which is about 2 seconds, to repair the gun. The lock and load takes 2 grenades to destroy a level 3 sentry, reducing the time for the engineer to react to just over a second. 1 second might not seem like much, but Team Fortress 2 is a very fast-paced game. 1 second is a giant reduction on the time a player has to react. Engineers have 4 buildings to manage upgrading and protecting, keeping up with their metal supply to make sure they can repair all of their buildings at any time, and making sure that they themselves aren't picked off from a distance. The lock and load forced engineers to sit directly behind their sentry doing nothing but hitting it, just on the off chance some 12-year-old came along with the lock and load and ruined everybody else's fun. Scouts were one of the Demo Man's biggest counters. Demo Men's weapons were all projectiles, meaning that the scout's fast movement made it difficult for a Demo Man to reliably deal damage to the scout. The lock and load helped hide this weakness in the Demo Man's gameplay pretty well by making it significantly easier to counter scouts. The projectiles are easier to land, so the fast-moving target matters less, and you only need to hit him once to get rid of him. Game devs need to be very conscious of damage thresholds that are dangerous to cross. If you're allowing a character to be able to literally one-shot stuff, there needs to be a really, really good reason for it. Snipers landing a fully charged headshot on an enemy heavy will one-shot him, but it requires the sniper to not only land a very precise shot, but also to leave himself completely vulnerable while he charges up the shot. That makes it completely fine that the sniper can one-shot the enemy. It takes a very large risk and large amount of skill to obtain the large reward of one-shotting someone. If an ability is going to be able to one-shot a character, it needs to require a serious amount of skill on the player's part to do so. If it's too easy to receive the reward, it's too powerful.
And speaking of too easy to receive the reward...
Here we go.
So this is where we start to play pretty fast and loose with what the word overpowered actually means. Quite frankly, there's been many Hearthstone decks that are more traditionally overpowered than Questrogue. I'm pretty sure that Pirate Warrior, Overload Shaman, Jade Druid, and Undertaker Hunter could pretty easily take this spot instead. For those of you out of the loop, the Caverns below is a quest card for Rogue. The quest's super simple, you just play four cards with the same name. If you complete the quest, it rewards you with a spell that, when cast, turns all of your minions into 5/5s for the rest of the game. The quest itself costs one and always starts in your opening hand, but the quest reward itself after you've completed the quest costs 5. It seems so innocent, just like all of the other stuff on this list. There shouldn't be a problem with a card that leans into a slow game plan and rewards you with a ton of value and damage for it. Quest Rogue's overpowered qualities came from elsewhere. It was considered overpowered because it was polarizing. Quest Rogue, when it was first nerfed, didn't even have a positive win rate. Its win rate was consistently sat around 49% and stayed there. Quest Rogue's problem's pretty simple. It gets completely run over by those fast aggressive decks, but is almost guaranteed a win against slow decks and combo decks. It turns Hearthstone, a game that entirely revolves around strategy and playing the odds, into essentially a complicated game of rock, paper, scissors. When you load up Hearthstone and try and queue up for Quest Rogue, you're rarely put in a game where you, the player, is showing your skill. You're just waiting to see what matchup you're given instead. Sure, Hearthstone had lots of decks that were matchup dependent, but for Quest Rogue, a winning matchup was almost guaranteed to win, and a losing matchup was almost guaranteed to lose. Not only was it not fun for your opponent when they were playing a slow deck, but it wasn't fun for you when you queued into a fast deck like a Murloc Paladin and they just ran you over in 2 minutes.
So we might turn into the Death Knight and then, okay. He knows how this goes.
Quest Rogue was never traditionally overpowered on release, but it made gameplay completely mind-numbing and it represented a massive design problem in the future. A lot of Quest Rogue's power came from burst damage. Cheap minions that can attack immediately like Boar, Deckhand, and Patches the Pirate make this deck a monster to face up against. It turned cheap and efficient minions into 5/5 tanks that can just smash your opponent in the face for free every single turn. If the meta was full of control decks that were super slow or had no aggressive decks that were good, Quest Rogue was just guaranteed to be powerful and dumpster favourable matchups. Even after 2 nerfs, we still see the same Quest Rogue shenanigans over and over again. Rogue still has so many resources to kill you with. At first it was just prep, vanish, and bounce cards on Boar, but now there's a combo with Zola the Gorgon, Valera the Hollow, and Vicious Scalehide that allows the rogue infinite healing and infinite 12-12s for the rest of the game. Not to mention that if they get a lucky draw, the quest rogue's not even that slow, they can complete it on turn 4, and even the infamously calm streamers get visibly frustrated by Quest Rogue.
Cool.
Checkmate. Well done.
Cool. Nice deck. I wonder why they're nerfing that card. I'm curious. Like, I mean, the deck doesn't really have a good win rate overall, right? Like, it you know, has a sub 50 win rate across levels of play, except it's bullshit.
In tournament play with open deck lists, pros are heavily punished for bringing a weak aggro deck to try and boost their win rate versus Quest Rogue, because the weak aggro deck doesn't fare very well against any of the other decks on offer. On the other hand, bringing Quest Rogue to a tournament while the meta has no strong aggro decks goes mostly unpunished. It has no losing matchups if there's no good aggro decks, so there's almost no counterplay to the strategy of bringing Quest Rogue to the tournament. Now I know, you could definitely argue that Questrogue shouldn't be in this video because it's not technically overpowered, and quite frankly, you've got a good point. But Questrogue still raises an interesting point about what actually makes something overpowered. If something dominates a certain matchup with almost 100% win rates, it will become a problem at some point. If, for example, there is a character that instantly wins matchups against aggressive playstyles, the moment that the meta favours aggressive playstyles, your counter character immediately breaks the meta wide open and demands hotfix nerfs. Questrogue limits design space just by existing. There has to be at least somewhat powerful aggressive options in the game at any given time, otherwise Questrogue's gonna destroy the meta, completely undefeatable by anything other than itself. I'm sure if you think really hard about it, there's tons of examples of this in tons of games. Ardent Censer in League of Legends, whilst that was overpowered, was super limiting for the meta. It forced you to run these shield supports. You might disagree with me, but I would personally argue that anything that limits design space this hard is overpowered. Game balance is such a difficult task. Appeasing the least skilled and most skilled players all at once while making sure nothing that's inherently broken is added to the game, and making sure that there's no exploits and bugs that break anything, is really, really hard. I really want people to learn what actually constitutes overpowered. I feel like it's all too common for video game communities to throw the word overpowered around just because they don't like something. It's not that rare to hear people screeching about how overpowered something is when 9 times out of 10, it's pretty well balanced. They just don't know what to do about the strategy it uses. People really need to learn the difference between powerful and overpowered. Powerful is okay, you know, one character being higher than another character on a tier list is fine. So next time little Timmy tries to tell you how overpowered Master Yi is, maybe link them to this video. Thanks for watching.